Everyone, my name's Glenn and welcome to The Way Back. This is my Nastesh YouTube channel that offers insight and inspiration to help you reclaim your life back from addiction and to find your way back. This is Steph.
Hi friends, I'm Steph. Glenn and I share a sobriety date. It is the 17th of October 2016. We support each other and we keep each other accountable. And with our interviews on this channel and video blogs, we hope to help you on your sobriety journey as well.
Fantastic. So we'll get straight to it. So first of all, I'd like to introduce my friend Kevin. Now, before I let Kevin speak, I'll just do a little bit of spiel. I met Kevin going back, I think, roughly 2 years now, I'm guessing. It must be close to 2 years. And we met him on the Onwards and Upwards group that we've talked about now and again. And Kevin, I don't want to go into it just yet, but I've got a very special bond with Kevin from day one, which I'll elaborate on. So I'm really excited about this. So hello, Kevin.
Hey, nice to be with you both. Thank you so much for the invitation.
Oh, thank you for accepting. Right, Steph.
Okay, well, I don't know as much of your story as Glenn does. So I guess I want to start with first tell us how long you've been alcohol free.
Since June 27th of 2015, that was the date. Actually, Glenn, you and I remember we were texting or messaging or something back and forth, and the original goal at that time was to go 90 days. I thought that would be enough of a challenge. Remember that, Glenn?
Oh, yes.
And it wasn't too long into that before finally, after years of stopping and starting up and starting and or stopping and starting up again, for whatever reason, the light went off and I realized, gosh, I don't even know. I don't remember when it was, Glenn, within that, but it wasn't long, a couple of weeks maybe. And I just kind of thought, oh, I'm done. I don't drink anymore. And so I long ago stopped counting days or months. I don't know how many months that is. It's just a little short of 2 years, but since late June of 2015.
That's fantastic. Awesome.
That is fantastic.
So can you then take us back to the time when you're in your life when alcohol had become, in your view, like problematic or, what did that look like?
I first remember thinking around 2005-ish, I think, that I remember calling a friend of mine. Ironically, I had breakfast with that same friend on that day, June 27th. At that point, he was 17 years sober. He and I used to announce together at a stock car racetrack, which I later became the general manager of. And I'm not blaming that industry, but beer was just the fuel of choice for social engagement around there. Now, I had set the habit into motion prior to that, but I remember feeling a lot of stress at that time. And I remember a conversation that I was having with him. I was sitting in my car and calling him and saying to him, Derek, I feel like I've got a problem. And so this would be 10 years before I ended up stopping for good, right? And I remember his response. He said something like, well, Kev, like that's a really personal choice. That's a personal thing. And he didn't jump in to tell me you should do this or you shouldn't do that. But it was then that I realized that I was kind of hooked into the idea of that alcohol was just part of my lifestyle. And to give you some context, I was never the type where I never drank during the day. I never got behind the wheel of the car. I don't have stories about, being passed out in a closet or waking up naked or anything like that. I never let my kids down. I never didn't show up to work. But I knew that I had it hooked into my psychology that you get home and you grab a can of Bud Light. It was automatic. I didn't even think about it. You want to relax? You have a beer. You want to celebrate? You have a beer. You had a bad day and you want to forget about it, you have a beer. You're doing chores. I'd be sitting and ironing my clothes for work and I'd drink a couple of beers while I was – I had it associated with everything. And had, I think, drawn apart the psychology of my day into the part that I have to do and then the part where I get to relax and enjoy it. And I had – this is 2017, Kevin, talking now. I wasn't thinking this way a couple of years ago. But that I think that I had associated it with now's the time where I get to relax or be happy or whatever you want to call it. And then I associated drinking with that. I didn't drink. I was never really a fan of liquor, not a wine drinker. But I very easily drank 5, 7, 8 cans of beer pretty much every night and did that for about 15 years. And through the course of that, tried to stop several times. And even in that year, 2015, I had gone all of January without drinking. And then I remember went on an overnight trip with a buddy to a concert. Thought, well, you know, we're away, we're having fun. And anyway, we've all got our stories. But I just, I finally got to a point where I started to think about my life. If it continued on the trajectory that I was on, what was it going to look like when I looked back on it? What would I regret? And then it really started to get to me thinking, I'm going to need my body. I'm going to need my mind. And I think everybody's got their own stories. I'm not into comparing how much you drank or what your experiences were. I know I had an issue. I was hooked into a destructive habit. My body was really starting to show the effects of that. I would wake up every single day with dark thoughts. I'd be in a rush. I'd press the alarm as much as I could. I'd feel in a fog. It's amazing that I got done what I did during that time while I was into that habit. And I think I arrived at a point where collectively, I was just ready to be done.
Wow.
Yeah. So my next question was going to be if you had some attempts at control drink, but it sounds like you did. You tried to stop a few times, tried to control.
Yeah, that's a fair thing to say, Steph. And I think, again, now this is 2017 version of Kevin talking. So there's been a lot of work done, not just with taking alcohol out of my life, but introducing a lot of other really positive, what I would call keystone habits as well. And I've done a lot of personal development work and courses and trying to understand how our minds work and why we believe the things that we believe and all this kind of stuff. So I think, Steph, that for me, it came down to an idea of what was normal. Like, for instance, I'll give you an example. It was February of last year, so 2016 at the time of this recording, that I was going to a vacation in Mexico at this all-inclusive resort. And I remember being a little perturbed with myself at how much energy I allowed it to take up of thinking, how do I do that without drinking?
I remember this really well.
Did we talk about that? And I did think I flip flop back. So how many months would that have been? 8, 9 into since I had put it down, and I was just cruising along. Christmas was no issue. Birthdays, parties, office parties, like all of that. Concerts, I'd done all of that. But this thought of being in this tropical area where liquor was just coming out of the taps for a week and not having a drink, I couldn't get my mind around. How do you do that? And I think it plays into the pictures that we all have of what's normal, what are we supposed to do? Mm-hmm. And so for me, I think that is indicative of a much larger issue than alcohol, of how we think we're supposed to live our lives. Mm-hmm. That I really have come to believe that a lot of us are following people that don't know where they're going and listening to people that really don't have much of value to say. And that's not meant as a criticism of them. But we just don't know. We're not really ever taught to look inside ourselves and understand what is it that really feeds us and resonates us the most or with us the most. We just look at what everybody else is doing and what everybody else has. And this is a generalization, I grant you that, and think, well, that's what we're supposed to do. And then we do those things and we're still not happy. Mm-hmm. So then what do we do? Well, you know, at the end of the week, 5 o'clock, the whistle blows, and like every country song ever invented, let's go down by the riverbed and the white t-shirt and the, you know, the whiskey and the beer. And it's like, so we buy into that, right? It's still a choice, but it's everywhere. So I couldn't wrap my mind around how do I be on this tropical beach and not have a drink? And finally, I actually got there and was still thinking about it. And everybody, like, they're handing alcohol to you, whatever else. And I said, oh, I just want a water. I just want a 7-Up. And it was only then that it clicked. It was like, well, I'm not any different here than I am at home. Mm-hmm. What I want is I want to be well. I want to wake up feeling clear. I want to soak in every single moment of this sunshine, of these palm trees, of the moments with the person that I love most in my whole life. How is alcohol going to help me with that? It's actually going to take me away from that, really.
Right.
And I realized, well, at home you just told yourself, I don't drink. But that was a big step for me because I realized, well, I am who I am and what I am no matter where I am, right? And it doesn't matter what anybody else is doing. And I'll grant you, at first, I got some looks like, okay, he's going to the bar and he's bringing back drinks for everybody else, which was easy to do because it was already paid for. And I just bring back a 7-Up or a water for myself. But once I got that into my head, no, I don't drink. Mm-hmm. Then it became easy. But there were these steps along the way, and that was one of the last ones that was really kind of a major one for me that I had to overcome. I can't even remember what the original question was. Forgive me. You're talking to a radio guy. I'll talk forever.
This is great. This is fantastic.
Yeah, good. One thing I got with what you were just saying is how alcohol, I mean, it not only holds, you know, some of us back to, you know, to a large extent, but like sort of society in at large. I mean, it's holding us back. How did it hold you back in your life personally?
Oh, wow. I'm just trying to think of where to start. I mean, if you have any kind of habit, whether it's alcohol or sugar or you're watching too much TV or whatever it is, even if it's a good habit, like all you do is run, sooner or later, your knees will break apart. Anyway, that's not a criticism of runners.
I'm not a runner.
I've learned through this, some people get really sensitive. So.
Right.
I was going to say you got to be careful, but, you know, again, I think we've got to look inside ourselves. I'm not trying to suggest that my story is what's right for you or anybody that's watching or listening. I'd encourage them to look back and see what resonates inside themselves. But for me, Steph, there was a physical deterioration. There was certainly a neurological deterioration. I started to really become – I remember a sense of despair thinking, I'm nowhere near to expressing what I know I'm capable of. And I'm just not functioning. The circuitry isn't firing up here to what I know that I could be doing. I was burning a lot of energy and thought of things that, you know, now I'm freed up doing things like podcasts and speaking and video blogs and music and things like that. And it sounds silly to say out loud, but just even the amount of time that you would think, how many beers do I have in the fridge? And do I need to go into the beer store again? And has it only been 2 days since I last went to that beer store? And if I go back in there, they're going to think, well, here comes that, you know, that rummy again. So I'll go to a different one. And, oh, I've got how many empties? So I need to take those back. But I don't want to do that while my kids are around because I don't want to see them doing that. And then I'd be like, okay, well, I'm not going to drink tonight because my kids are here. But then I get home. I'm like, but I really need a beer because it's time to relax. And, oh, just this once. And, like, just – it's exhausting.
It is exhausting, but, yeah.
You know, and even things like how many empties am I carrying out the front door at one mm-hmm. time and what are the neighbors thinking and mm-hmm. how many, like, it's just, man. And, you know, I had back troubles. I was on anxiety and depression medication. I couldn't sleep through the night. I was waking up a couple of times every night. I was convinced that I couldn't fall asleep without having a couple of beers. I would exercise 4 or 5 times a week, but I wasn't really getting the full benefit of that. And now I've never been healthier. I've never felt clearer. I've never gotten more done. It doesn't even occur to me to your point earlier, Steph, of moderation or controlled drinking. I've gotten to the point where why the hell would I bother?
Yeah.
What's the point? Like, yeah. I never was, if I'm going to have one beer, I may as well have 10. Like, so why would I want the one?
Mm-hmm.
And it's not a judgment thing. It's just that, no, it's not for me. So I drink water like it's going out of fashion. I don't have time to take empties back because I spend too much time in the washroom getting rid of all that water.
Yeah.
But those were a lot of the things. There was a feeling of – there were a lot of other things that went on in my life. Glenn, you know that there was a separation and then a divorce about 6 years ago from now. I had a company that I had helped build from the ground up, and it was downsized. And so I had all these things, not necessarily because of alcohol – although that was a regular thing in my life, but I say in one of my speeches that all of the labels that I had attached to myself, Kevin the husband, Kevin the homeowner, Kevin the everyday dad, at least in terms of when I got to see my kids, Kevin the business owner, the songwriter, the radio guy, all fell away within the course of a few months down to just Kevin. And the way that I dealt with that at that time was to just, I just threw alcohol on it, right? Because I deserve to. Woe is me, poor Kevin. But I remember having a real sense of despair at that time of like, I've run out of time. I had a shot at life and I've screwed it up. And if they put me in the ground now, I never will have known the relationship I wanted to have, expressing the creativity I wanted to express. contributing to my community and my friends and the world that the way that I wanted to earn the amount of money that I know I was capable of. And my psychology then was I've run out of time. But through the work over the next few years, it started to turn to, well, what can I do to make the most of the time that I have left? And then it became a model of moving towards something rather than moving away. So with alcohol, when I focused on, I have to stop, I shouldn't, I need to put this down, it's bad if I pick it up, I couldn't get away from it. It kept popping up like a punching dummy, that game of whack-a-mole. But once I got my mind around, and this is where the Superman thing came in, right, Glenn? Once I got my mind around, no, we're moving toward this. So the things that aren't going to feed that need to fall away. I've done it this way for the last 20 years, and here's what it's got me. Let's try the opposite of that. That's when it started to really fall away and get entrenched in my everyday habit.
And just for me to jump in quickly, Kevin, was that you spoke earlier about obviously the initial goal was like the 90 days. Did you pick up on that before the 90 days was out that, oh, the penny dropped for you? I'm dropping all this and I'm only going upwards from here on. Or did it take longer? Did you go through the 90 days? I can't remember.
Do you mean when I decided I knew I was done drinking?
Yeah, when everything just got better and it was like, right, this is it. This is what I want.
Well, for the drinking, it was probably, like we talked about a little earlier, I can't remember. It was early on in there, Glenn. It was maybe a couple weeks, 10 days. And I just kind of went, oh, I'm done with drinking. But the lead up to that was a process that was several years. So you mentioned Onwards and Upwards and Kevin O'Hara earlier. You know, I had come across him by just putting into Google or YouTube or something like how to stop drinking, and saw him. And that was probably, I don't know when he started doing those videos, but I'm going to say it was late 2012, 2013, somewhere in there. And I remember, just so you know, at that time, I had these random patches of hair that had all fallen out. I just felt this constant anxiety all the time. I even had people that had pulled me aside at work and said, like, Kevin, are you all right? Like, is everything okay? And I was going to work every day. I was earning a living and taking care of my kids. In a lot of ways, I was happy, but my body was telling me, dude, we have some adjustments to make. And I started listening to here's this guy, Kevin O'Hara from Spain, just on his journey, talking, just being himself, right? And I could relate to that. And so I subscribed, and I just, even though I was still drinking and at that point I had broken it up to where I'd drink for two or three nights and then I'd stop for a night or two. And then that went on for a while. But he did one video where he mentioned, and I talked to him about this when I had him on my podcast. He did a video where he talked about some personal development books that had made a difference for him. And one of them that he mentioned was called The Magic of Thinking Big by David J. Schwartz. I don't know why, but I went and I picked it up. And I started reading it, and again, I thought, well, I've done this all my way up to this point, and I'd read a lot of books like that. But that one, for whatever reason, was the right one at the right time, and I remember thinking, I'm just going to do everything in here that it says to do. Mm-hmm. And it didn't say stop drinking, start exercising, drink more water, meditate, yoga, whatever else. It said things like, you know, speak up, start conversations with people, sit at the front of the room, just things like this, right? Mm-hmm. It talked about excusitis. What are the excuses that you're making for yourself? About your health and the amount of money you make and your environment and your surroundings. If you're, you know, looking at any and focusing on limitations at all, you're making excuses for yourself. So I started to get really honest with myself about all that. And that's where it started. And I would say that was around the fall of 2013, just to put this into context, okay? And I remember really digging in a lot harder at work that fall. And all of a sudden, things started to turn. I was still drinking, but things started to turn where I was getting more positive results in my life. That creativity was starting to fire back up. And, you know, I kept Kevin's voice and a number of others into my mind. I remember I had been thinking about doing a podcast because of my radio background, but had this little voice going, you can't do a podcast. Who the heck do you think you are? What are you like? Where are you going to find time for that? Anyway. Into 2015, I had built enough momentum that I was really getting into the psychology more of what can I be? Mm-hmm. How do I want my life to look as opposed to what I want to get rid of? And again, I think it comes back, even like Steph, we talked about, you know, moderation or what does normal look like. You get to a point where you're not worried about normal. You're worried about you, not even worried, interested, that you want to contribute in and be kind, contribute to everybody else, because you really start to feel a connection with them, but you also start to understand how you got to take care of yourself. If you're looking for anybody else to do that for you, you know, I wish you the best of luck. Reality is that people are, and we get tied up into what do people think about me and what do they mean by this text or that email or this. It's not about us. It's about them, right? But that's a whole other conversation. And I had an idea in my mind of what sobriety meant. And I thought, you know, missing out, separate, depriving yourself of something. It was at the corner of the, like, there's a dance going on and the sober person is the one that's standing on the wall all by themselves, right? Mm-hmm. Separate from the group. These are the pictures that came to my mind. And then it was one day, and Glenn, you know part of this story, but when I was struggling in the lead up to the 90-day thing that you and I talked about, I saw the Superman logo. And I looked at that and I thought, that S might just as well stand for sober as it does for Superman. And when I thought about that, I thought, okay, well, what does he stand for? He's strong. He's flexible. He's passionate. He has his weaknesses, has his down moments, but energetic. And that changed the picture for me. So I started plastering that logo all over my house and at the keychain, and just, and it became a real thing. And it changed the picture for me. And pretty soon into having dropped alcohol, I found out that my actual experience of what it was the complete opposite of what my picture was. It wasn't separate at all. I was the one that was diving right in and connecting with people and expressing me at my creativity and feeling more energetic and focused than ever. Now, that's my story. I don't know if it will be the same for everybody else. Mm-hmm. But, you know, there's so many other people that have gone before us and done it. But when you're in the fog of it and it's got its hold of you, it's really hard to see, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, it sounds like this was more of a process for you than a rock bottom or a single defining moment. Or can you speak of like a defining moment or an aha moment?
To think about that, I don't think there was one. I just think there was a series of them. Mm-hmm.
I think,
you know, like I said, I never drove my car into the ditch or anything like that. Mm-hmm. But I knew, you know, I knew that my life was ticking away and my body was breaking down and my mind wasn't right, and I really felt like I was letting my kids down. And that was a big one. And
I just remember, I mean, do a little snapshot, just because you mentioned the Superman logo again, and I've still got those pictures in my head of you and your sons, and it was just a big deal at the time, and there was a lot of I got a lot of pride from your own sons having pride in you, you know. It was just this fantastic, it was a powerful thing at the time. It really was. It was special.
That's interesting to hear, and they've been a big part of this journey because they have actively participated in knowing that I've struggled with it.
Yeah.
And we've talked very openly about it. And my youngest son, who's now 10, I mean, he would ask once we got into the course of when they knew I was trying to stop, he would ask me, did you have anything to drink today, Dad? Did you have a beer today? Wow. And I'd say no. He'd say good job. And yet at the same time, there were things like he would tell me he liked going into the beer store, what we call here in Ontario, Canada, the liquor store or something like that. And we all, you know, we remember what it's like when we're kids and we're with our moms and our dads and we see what grown-ups do. And there's that idea of back to normal. And I knew, like, Steph, to your question earlier, I'm like, through my habit, I'm building a picture in my child's mind of what's normal.
Yes.
And I wasn't all right with that, but I couldn't stop myself from doing it for a matter of years. Mm-hmm. After I was aware of that. But once I finally stopped, and Glenn, to your point about involving them in the Superman thing, like, and you're right, it has been a team effort. We've really discussed it. Glenn, they know who you are. They know who mm-hmm. Kevin O'Hara is. Steph, they'll know who you are. Because I talk to my kids about this. About, like, look, guys, I'm not telling you don't ever have a drink or I'm not going to be proud of you. I'm saying these are the things that go on in life, mm-hmm. you know, that we're going to face. there are these conversations that we view as difficult with our partners, with our kids, with ourselves, that in my view, I think should be fundamental, like about alcohol, about drugs, about sex, about whatever. These things happen. Why don't we want to talk about them? And I don't know about you, but I went into my life going like, I don't really know how this works. I don't know what to do. So what do? You ask people that also don't know, because they're trying to figure it out too. Because the adults, oh, that's taboo. So I'm like, guys, you know, go live your life. Do what you're going to do. But just remember your experience firsthand with your dad to see how hard he's had to work and how much it's meant to him to have to try to move through it. Mm-hmm. And just remember what life was like during that struggle and what it's been like since that switch went off. And it's been the same thing with the relationship and divorce and getting back into another relationship and all that. My former wife and I are great friends. He and I are great friends as well. The woman that I have a relationship now is just, I mean, it's incredible, but we've had a lot of work along the process. And then it starts conversations like where my kids ask me about things like, what's the difference between being married and being in love? We don't know these things. You know, we're taught how to go through school to read and write and add 2 + 2, but we're never effectively taught how to actually communicate with other human beings and understand that we all have our own perspectives. And we go out into the world and we do what we think that we're supposed to do. Now I'm soliloquying here, but, and then, you know, we do what we think we're supposed to, and we still got that emptiness in here. So what do? A lot of us, what I did was I started drinking. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, this feels good. Everything else feels wrong, but this feels good. So more of that must be better. And next thing you know, you know the rest of that story.
Definitely do. Yep.
You mentioned trying to, give up alcohol for your kids. And it reminds me, Glenn and I just mentioned this in our first interview, I think, the Elizabeth Vargas story. She's the TV anchor, U.S. TV anchor. And she was talking about how she would die for her children, but she couldn't give up drinking for them. Like, you have to reach a point where, you know, you have to do it for yourself. And I mean, I could certainly relate to that. I know that Glenn could as well, but I tried so many times. You know, I had those moments of just, you know, tears streaming down my face and looking at their picture or thinking about them and like, I'm going to do this for them. And there was so much resolve. It was very, you know, very strong emotion would overtake, you know, and then the following day it would just be by 2-3 o'clock in the afternoon, you know, well, and there'd be some excuse and then, you know, would do it again. So, So for you, what was that process like of sort of coming to the realization that this had to be for you?
I'm glad you brought that up because, I mean, it is for me. I think as I alluded to earlier, at least for me, I feel like if I want to live the life that I want to live, it's got to be up to me. You know, I've got to take ultimate responsibility and be accountable for my own experience. And again, I can't speak for anybody else's experience other than my own. But I learned the hard way that if you attach your sense of self and personality to anything external from you, it doesn't matter whether it's alcohol, a job, your kids, a creative project, that's external. You know, even your name is not, that was chosen for you. That's not who you really are. So what does that mean? Well, to your point, Steph, I mean, there isn't anything that I wouldn't do for my two kids. It is by far the most important thing in my life. But they've got their own lives. Mm-hmm. You know, it isn't always going to be the way that it is right now, or they're just in the other room and they know their dad's doing this interview and we're going to go and have a great day. But, you know, they're getting older. They're going to go off and they're going to have their own lives. Mm-hmm. And I know people that have attached their whole personality to being the parents of their kids, and that's very noble. But two things. Are you equipping yourself to have a sense of meaning and fulfillment and purpose for when they move on to their lives? And are you also empowering them to do the same? Mm-hmm. So I feel a real sense of responsibility, not just to myself, but to them and to the people that are around me. And Glenn, it really means a lot to me to hear the things that you're saying and some of the things that you have said to me along the way, because I've read and I've seen things about, like, when something evolves, everything around that thing evolves as well. And that's very different from saying, you know, from getting up on your pedestal and saying, thou shalt be like this. I can't tell you that. I don't know what's right for Steph or for Glenn. I don't know. I can tell you what served me well and what hasn't. But to be able to, I want my kids to see that you can do whatever it is that you want to do. And I know that that's cliche, but there's a script. There's still a script. We're like I said earlier, we're just following along with all these people that don't know where they're going. And that's not an indictment. For a long time, I've been one of them. And I see why I'm comfortable. You've got to start to believe that you can't see yet. And then you've got to be willing to go through to break out of your comfort zone if you want the experiences that you always think that you wanted to have. And you've started, you kind of get into that psychology of, what do I really want? And it might not be a big house by the sea or a fast car or whatever else. I mean, for me, it's traveling and adventures. And Glenn, you'd probably be really humbled to hear that I could play you out. I wish I had my iPod here. I'd show you, like, affirmations and visions that I've recorded on my own. One of them says that I'm traveling and I'm going over to the UK and meeting with Glenn and some of my Onwards and Upwards pals to celebrate the life that we've created. And I feel like, to draw it back to where we started on this question, that I have a responsibility to myself and my kids to show them, like, that's a you job. You know, like, you're going to go through, pay attention in school, pay attention at work. There's a part of life where, you know, you've got to do the work and sort of conform a little bit, but always hold tight to that piece of yourself to build that awareness and to know, and to constantly tune into what really matters to you. And you've got to learn to trust that and to follow that. And so it's really ironic to me that I used changing my, you know, paradigm of the divorce. How am I supposed to act with this? So we got to be miserable and enemies and all that. And I remember thinking, that's stupid. Who wants to live like that? But that was the only picture that I had in my mind. But I thought, no, I don't want to live that way. And it was hard at first, but time went on and then things got really good. And I referred back to that when I was quitting drinking. I thought, well, if I can change my psychology and my habits about that, I can change it with this. And at first it was really hard, but as time went on and I was driving to something as opposed to trying to get away from something, it got easier. Now, and for the last good long while, I've been thinking, okay, well, I want to have these experiences. I want to do these things. I want to make this amount of money. I want to have these adventures. And I'm thinking about, well, because it seems really, how the heck am I ever going to figure that out? And I'm thinking back now about, well, if you could do that with alcohol, and if you could do that with your relationship, you can do it with this. But just like I say in one of my speeches, race like a turtle. You know, we all want to be the lion and big and blustery and all this kind of stuff. And we all think we know the fable of the tortoise and the hare. We know the tortoise wins. We know, all of us know that, right? And yet we're all still trying to figure out how we can be the first to be the hare and just go with the engine pegged all the way through without having it blow. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. So, you know, those little things add up. You know, when you're counting days, when you're counting minutes, when you hit a tough spot and you got to reach out on it, doesn't, and geography isn't even an issue anymore. My accountability buddy was Mr. Barkley here. You know, we're in completely different parts of the world. That anything else is, it's an excuse. Reach out, connect with someone, and it'll pull you forward.
Amazing. Oh, Kevin, you're putting a massive smile on my face.
Good.
It's such a pleasure to do this. You know, I know I'm going off script slightly, but it's just, you just, there was two names in my, as you know, it took me ages to finally get sober. I relapsed after relapse, and for many different reasons. And I, looking back now, I just didn't quite get it. It was as simple as that. But there was you and a man called David right in the beginning, and you both, you never gave up on me, you know, and you'll always be in my heart for that, you know, because back then I was a complete pain as well. You know, I was just this guy who didn't get it. I'd say all the right things. Look how good I am, everyone. Make silly videos. And 2 hours later, I'd be drinking again. You know, and I did that for so long. But you're just one of those guys, or you're just that guy that, you know, you were always there for me. And I just really want you to know, I really appreciate that. Because even now, that was probably like, I don't know, two and a half years ago. And I'm only now coming up for 6 months sober. You know, it's taken me that long to get. But yeah, I just want a big sort of heartfelt thank you, because that means you actually, all your help and kind words mean a lot to me. And I definitely wouldn't be where I am right now without you. I can guarantee that.
It's nice to hear. That's nice to hear.
I
feel the same way about you. And I guess, thank you, Glenn. And you know, like, everybody's hurting. In some sense, you know, and I think this is part of the trap that we fall into up here and in here, is that we look at athletes and celebrities and whomever else, all just stuff external, and think, well, if I can just get what they have, if I can have a fame or money or achievement or Facebook followers or whatever, then I'll be happy. They all have people that die and tough relationships and people get sick, and like, there's none of us that don't go through that if we're human beings, right? And when you can reach out with, and like, and even you're saying, Glenn, like silly online videos, I felt the same way about trying to break out of my comfort zone. And I had a background in media and broadcasting, and I felt tremendous anxiety about putting myself back behind the microphone and in front of a camera, because I was thinking, who the hell do you think you are? What are you doing? You don't have any right to tell anybody anything, but you can share your experiences. And I found that when we can just be really open and really honest and share authentically with other people, it has this instant magnetic connection, you know, that makes the relationships deeper, I think. And that, along the lines of everybody's hurting, like, to be able to go, like, I'm with you. You know, I'm with you. I don't know why we need to have any more of a commonality other than we're human beings. We're all going through stuff. I'm with you. I might not necessarily agree with you, but I'll walk beside you. And, you know, and to each our own along those lines. And, it's amazing what can happen when you throw good energy out to somebody. And now I'm wandering around all over the place, but
no, it's fine. Sorry, that was my fault. But I would just, when myself and Steph came up with this idea to do this channel, obviously we wanted to put my old videos on, Steph's old videos to start with, and then it was like, where are we going to go for now? And then we came up with the interview idea, and it was like, okay, who are we going to interview now? Your name was on my list. Your name was right up there, obviously. And but it, maybe for different reasons than people expect, it wasn't. It is about the drinking. That's obviously where it starts. But you're a perfect example of someone who was in this dark place of drinking, but just the journey of being on. And it's quitting drinking was just the beginning. You know, that was it was hardly anything. But where you and the man you've become today, and all the little projects and all the big projects you've got going in your life, and you've really got yourself together. I know you've still got problems, we all have, but sure. You know, I want to get the message over to people watching who won't know you, that you were back. I knew you when you were in this little dark place, and like possibly people hang out, you know. And there's a big old big light at the end of this tunnel, isn't there? You know, you just got to point yourself in that direction, and sort of there you go. And you're just a perfect example of do the right things. And I mean, I'm just listening to you, and you're just motivating me now just by speaking. I want to stop drinking again. I'm that bloody motivated right now.
I remember, Glenn, you sharing stories and photos of your hikes. Yeah. Steph, I hope you don't feel like we've ganged up on you here and excluded you. It's just,
No.
We're running into some of the remembrances. And you know, it occurs to me, Glenn, that you and I have never actually spoken to each other. Could that be true?
This is true.
I mean, we've texted or messaged and all of that kind of stuff. But, you know, seeing back to the pictures of your hikes, like, there's an entirely different energy even behind the photos and the spirit behind it. You can, you know, buy into that or believe in that if you want or if you don't. Again, I can only speak from my own experience that you just, you get the sense of the expression of the experience of this person that's empowering themselves and doing something that feeds them positively. Mm-hmm. And then you juxtapose that with, I'm a complete mess. The bottom's fallen out again and here's what's happened. But you know that there's that light there. You know that there's, like, it's there. And it's in there for everybody. And I find it's funny, like, after I did my podcast with Kevin O'Hara, almost a year ago, I actually had people emailing me, angry at me, that, like, that I wasn't drunk enough. Like, I'm paraphrasing, but I'm just like, you know, this isn't a competition.
No.
Like, it's about living life. Here's another one, Glenn, that you and I have talked about, the Rocky films. Rocky is a part of my speech, Rise Like a Phoenix, Race Like a Turtle, because I think a lot of people look at Rocky as the picture of strength, right? Here's this big, muscly guy, the Italian stallion that goes through other people, right? And the original Rocky and my favorite one, Rocky Balboa, from like 30 years later when he gives that epic speech to his son. Let me tell you something that you already know. The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a mean and a nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it'll beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. Anyway, those films, they make people jubilant, right? Why? He doesn't win. He doesn't win. It's not about winning. It's about living. He wants to matter. He wants to do something bigger than what he perceives himself to be. He wants more out of life. He wants to challenge himself beyond what he thinks are his current limitations. And he wants to love, right? More than he wants to beat Apollo Creed and have a title or an accolade, he wants the relationship with that mousy little woman in the pet store because he sees more from her than she sees in herself. And we look at that and we think, well, we got to be the guy, the heavyweight champ, right? And the money and the fame and the belt and the – you're missing it. You're missing it. Why does it make you feel so good? It's about living. And that's where the turtle thing comes in. Everybody misses. He has pet turtles in every single one of those films.
Yes.
Why?
Right.
Why? Do you think it's a coincidence that, like, everybody wants to be the lion, right? But the turtle is the picture of endurance, perseverance, wisdom, innocence, motherhood, creation, protection. It has very few natural predators, right? And it goes inside itself when it needs to protect. And it watches everybody else flying around the room like a balloon going out of air. And just kind of continues on. Like, are you done? Okay, let's keep going. But our pictures in our minds is we've got to be the big shiny object. And you're like, turtle? Turtle?
Yeah.
Go back and watch Rocky. Then watch Rocky Balboa from 30 years later. Watch Creed. Listen to what he says to Adonis Creed. You see that face looking back at you in the mirror? That is your toughest opponent. I believe that in boxing and I do believe that in life. I see that and I'm like, let's consider this for a moment. You're trying to tell me that I get into this ring and there's a 250-pound behemoth coming across at me ready to knock my block into the middle of next week, and you're telling me that my toughest opponent is myself? Yep. And it's exactly the same way in life, and it's exactly the same way with alcohol. You can blame all the advertisements and all the other people and all the habits and everything else in life all you want. You could blame me for not being drunk enough. You could blame you guys for not having the right guest on. But that's a you problem.
Mm-hmm.
It's a you job, right? Like, if you're seeing too many advertisements, turn it off. Oh, but I like my soccer game, or I like my hockey game, and the beers are... Turn it off. Oh, but turn it off, if that's what you have to do. Oh, well, I'm not having enough positive thoughts. Then unfollow everybody that's on Facebook. The little button that says unfollow but remain friends, or whatever it says, that anybody that wants to bitch and crank about the government, or thank God it's Friday, or it's wine night with the ladies, or turn it off and start following people that post positive affirmations and start saying oh, well, that's Pollyanna and that's Goody Two Shoes. Fine. That's how I thought too. Go ahead and be miserable. And if you want me or anybody else's, that's cool, but you've got to be responsible for you. You're the only one that can choose what you want to see. Do you want to see Rocky the winner? Why do Rocky 2, 3, and 4, and Rocky 4 is the funniest, right, Glenn? I must break you. They're not as good. They're like cartoons. Why? He wins. Yeah. The point of it's lost. It doesn't resonate. It's about living. So stop worrying so much about what everybody else is doing. It doesn't matter how many days I have sober, or you have sober, or whether I'm going to AA, or whether I'm not, or whether I'm part of another program, or I have a mentor, or I have a... It doesn't matter. Listen to everybody. Trust no one. Have that little filter that lets it in, but that blocks out the stuff that is going to not serve you, and trust yourself to figure it out. It doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be easy at first, but it's doable. Just those little tiny steps. When you set a goal and you set a date to it, it'll make you both keenly aware of how fast time goes by, but also of how quickly all those little things do add up. When you've been drinking every single day for a long, long time, 90 days, 30 days, a week, 2 days, one, feels monumental, maybe even impossible. But when you can stumble and crawl and pull yourself like a baby deer on the ice, that you're moving forward, because you're not going to get another chance, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you're here now. Like, this is, do you have any idea what a miracle it is that you exist? That you don't even have to think about breathing or how to walk or how to talk. You just do it. And you can still do it, even though you've been just throwing toxic poison into yourself. You're still here. That means you're still in the game, right? Like, don't expect yourself to be perfect. You're going to fall. But, like, a little bit at a time, you're going to get stronger, and you're going to get stronger, and you're going to get stronger. And I apologize for getting so verbose, but I feel really passionate about it because I see what it's done for me. And it's not that I want to tell anybody how they are supposed to live their lives. I just want them to be happy. I just want you to be happy. It might not have anything to do with me, but just for yourself, for the people in your life, for your community, for whoever you can affect. You know, one person can make a difference. Even if the only person that the difference is made for is the one that you see in the mirror, that's enough. And you'd be amazed at how, when you can flourish on your own journey, everything else around you starts to evolve. And that's, I think, the ripple effect that we can have, not by, like, be passionate about stuff and believe in whatever it is you want to believe in, but if you're going to go stand in a street corner and hold a sign and try to affect everybody else to bend them to your will, we've been doing that for thousands of years. Just let's get ourselves right, and let's be kind to the person that's with us right here today, and that will through the generations. We may not be around to see it, or maybe I'll reincarnate as a beetle or something. I don't know, but I'm here now, right?
Yeah.
So I guess if I could leave anybody with that, it would be that. You are so much more than you realize, but just put your mind onto the trick that the answers, the real strength, the kind that will serve you going forward, isn't where you think it's going to be. Put on Rocky and watch it again. but watch it through the lens that I just gave you, because it's right in front of your nose and we don't see it because we're programmed the other way. And start to become attuned to how things make you feel, even things that you would enjoy. I stopped listening to aggressive rock music for a while, and I like rock. You might not, but I became aware that it was agitating to me. I stopped listening to Jimmy Buffett for a while. I love Jimmy Buffett, but there's too much margarita and pina colada talk in there. And I didn't want to hear it because I had associated it with, in order to relax and have the lifestyle easy and breezy, I had to have a drink in my hand. So I put that to the side for a while. Mm-hmm. It came back. I'm fine with it now. But just, you know, to guard your psychology and your experience religiously, it becomes fun. It's not a drawback. It's because you're working on you. You're giving yourself the best gift that you could possibly get. Mm-hmm. And if you need help, message me. Reach out to me. Message staff. Message. We're easy to find. You know, if you type Kevin Bulmer into Google, you will find me on all social media. You'll find my webpage. Email me at kevin@kevinbulmer.com. I will respond to you if you think that I can even just be an ear. And Glenn, I guess I would toss it back to you about, you know, even just knowing that somebody else is there and isn't going to judge, but that knowing no matter what's going on, I know I can send a note to or reach out to him or her, and I know I'm not going to be judged, how powerful that can be.
Yeah. Wow. That was powerful. Thank you for that. You were speaking about, you know, we create our own experience, and I was listening recently to your interview with Katie Kozlowski. Did I say that right?
Kozlowski,
she was saying how, you know, sometimes in life our biggest downfalls can become our greatest assets. So can you kind of speak to how, having gone through the experience of addiction and giving up alcohol, how that has become an asset in your life?
There are a lot of reasons. I'll try to make it more succinct than these long answers I've been giving you. Well, one I mentioned before is that I, you know, it's funny because you can't see this when you're in the fire, but mm-hmm. I look back at it and I think if I could do that, I can do this. Meaning the things that, like the podcast existing, and now that I'm starting to deliver keynote speeches and envisioning the lifestyle that it seems so far out there. Mm-hmm. And there are those, who do you think you are thoughts that come out, right?
Yeah.
And I think back to how I thought about myself and what I fundamentally had to have, meaning coming home from work at the end of the day and a drink in my hand. So, well, if I can change that, I can change this. Mm-hmm. And that's no small thing. The health is such a huge thing that it became about trying to replace the habit of alcohol and the consumption of it with other things that, you know, now I've bought into the morning routine thing so that every single day, you know, I get up and I meditate for about 12 minutes. I write down, I've got like usually two or three books. I'll read two or three pages of each and I'll write down notes. Like I'll highlight them and I'll write notes about what I think applies to me and my journey. I wish I had this stuff. I have it handy. I'll show you. And I write down affirmations every single day, and I write down my goals every single month. Again, the pre-sobriety Kevin would think that the current Kevin was an absolute pansy. Full disclosure, right?
Yeah.
Like, what the – are you talking about meditation, yoga,
gratitude,
affirmations? Yeah, like, so, like, you're some tree-hugging, Birkenstock-wearing dude who's sitting on the cloud saying,
Yeah.
You can call it whatever you want. But 2017, Kevin, if I could get in my DeLorean and hit 88 miles an hour and go back 5 or 6 years, that version of Kevin would be like, what's with you, man? Yeah. This Kevin would go, how's all this working out for you? Mm-hmm.
Are you happy?
Anyway, like I said, I'd show you. So, like, here's this morning. I don't know if you can see that or not. But, like, okay, so what are some of the books? That I'm working on right now. Go and get that, everybody.
Oh, I've got that book.
Get that book and read it. The supreme good is like water, which nourishes all things without even trying to. It's content with the low places that people disdain. The supreme good is not about Jack Daniels. Jack Daniels is about Jack friggin' Daniels. They just want your money.
Yes.
So anyway, I have on one of the things that I'm trying to do, I can show you. Here are some of my goals. I've never shown this to anybody. All right? How many, what it says is meditation minutes, water intake, yoga sessions, mm-hmm. new business calls. This relates to my business. So, like, you know, I have a goal to drink 2 liters of water every day. Why? Because I want to be like water. I want to nourish all things without trying to. I wasn't doing all this stuff right off the bat after stopping drinking, but this, it plays into the journey, mm-hmm. right? Is that you will evolve. And if you can think about it in terms of, I think, rather than, because this was always my psychology, guys. Once this happens, then I'll be happy. Yeah. Once this result takes place, then everything will be okay. It could be different things for everybody. Once this amount of money, once I have this job, once I find the perfect relationship partner, once I get this new handbag, or I have that shiny new car, or once I get home at the end of the day and I've got my feet up on the couch and a beer in my hand, then I'll be happy. Mm-hmm. When you can get into like, no, everything's fine right now. I'm exactly where I need to be right now. Mm-hmm. And have a goal. Put your ex on the map where you think that your treasure is. And that could be an achievement, a job, a relationship, an improvement in a relationship, a new skill. It doesn't matter. Weight loss, it doesn't matter. But don't hinge your sense of contentment and satisfaction on the achievement of that. Mm-hmm. Immerse it into the process. Yes. Be proud of failing yourself forward. Become aware of, hey, I'm doing this. I'm out of the airplane, and I am scared out of my mind, but I know that the chute is going to open here, and then it will. And it's we had this wrong for the first almost years of my life. And I even had a post-it note. It's still on the mirror up in my room where it says, happiness is a choice rather than a result. I knew that. I had it on that note, but I wasn't living from that. Mm-hmm. Is that when you just take all these little acts and you can be proud of yourself that you're making that effort, like, you'll get there, mm-hmm. wherever there is. But even where you are now is a there that you had in your mind at one point. You used to not be able to walk or talk. Figured that out. Well, that's silly, Kevin. Okay, well, how about there was a time when we all wanted to learn how to drive a car, and that felt so far off into the distance. How are we ever going to do that? Or, you know, kiss somebody, or be in a relationship, or get our first job. These things feel monumental and huge at one point, mm-hmm. but they're all part of our collective here. They used to feel like they're way out there. So, like, anyway, this gets kind of confusing, but like, the past is done, right? Like, so I would only encourage myself to look back into that in terms of honest evaluation of what can I learn from that to serve me well going forward. Mm-hmm. The future doesn't exist yet, as far as I can tell. Shaping on how we feel about it and the actions that we take today that are driven by the thoughts that we generate. All of us can choose that. If you want to believe that the world is a bad and a mean and a nasty place, you know, if you want to believe that all hope is lost, if you want to believe that you can't, that's your choice. Nobody can decide that for you. But it's just like right now is all that there is. And I know that's really difficult when I apologize, Steph. I'm way from the original question that you had. When people are down And I know, like, Glenn, you and I have, we're connected to a lot of the same people. Like, what do you say to somebody when they have no money and they have no relationships and they, you know, they're geographically removed from others and they're so caught into alcohol or a drug or some sort of destructive behavior that even all sense of identity and self is just buried under all of that? You could have a guy like me saying all this stuff that he wants, but when you're in that pit, you know, you're just looking for, you're not even in a dark room stumbling around trying to find the light switch. You're in a dark room lying on the floor. You know, and you just, somehow there just needs to be a candle lit there. I apologize. I've taken us off to lose the thread. But I guess I would say, well, but where you are now, if you're still breathing, if you're still functioning, like, do whatever you have to do and make it look and found. Go watch Rocky Balboa. If mm-hmm. it sounds cliche or whatever it is that you want. At that part when he goes, get up.
Yeah.
Get up. Call somebody. Go to a meeting. Call a hotline. Just. Like one step, yeah. You know, you don't have to be doing all the things that I do or that somebody else does, or just, you know, just choose one thing and then get that candle lit and then get yourself back on your feet. Then look for the light switch, mm-hmm. then turn it on, yeah. then take a look around at the room around you, then start thinking about how you can decorate it,
yeah.
then paint the walls, then open the windows. And then start thinking about building other rooms onto the house. You know, you could put whatever metaphor or analogy onto it that you want, but you're here right now. And if you're still breathing, you've got a chance.
Yeah.
You got a shot. And I believe in you. And I know that Steph and Glenn believe in you. And, you know, there are some nasty things going on in the world, but most of us are good. You know, we just want you to be well. So I guess...
Yeah.
Reach out to somebody and they'll help you along.
Wow. Thank you, Kevin. That is
yeah.
very powerful. Powerful stuff. Yeah. Amazing.
Definitely said, yeah.
But I was just going to say on that, you know, that was kind of a 10-year process for you, and it was for me, and it even longer. And I mean, for a lot of people it is. It's not something that you just, you know, like you say, you know, look for the candle, look for the light switch. That can take a period of time, but don't give up, you know? Because you will get it. And as Glenn often says, like, don't, what do you say? Keep quitting. Keep quitting till you quit.
Until you quit.
You know, it'll stick. It'll stick. Yeah.
You mentioned that podcast with Katie Kozlowski.
Yeah.
And that was all about loving yourself.
That's right.
And just quickly, that notion had never occurred to me. What the heck does that mean?
Mm-hmm.
Love myself. So the key to life is being conceited and arrogant? That's what I thought.
Yes.
No. It's about, if there's, again, I'm back to Rocky. Glenn, I know that you'll know this. Stuff in a basement. Tell me about the stuff. It's this emptiness, but you can't see that. Here's the basement, you know,
yeah.
your gut.
Yeah.
That there's this emptiness, this hole that a lot of us are carrying inside with us, and we try to fill it up with alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
With relationships, with money, with jobs, with status, with labels, with whatever it might be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can't fill it with anything that's outside of you.
No.
You can't. The only thing that can give you a sense of wholeness is yourself. And it almost sounds counterintuitive. Like, it sounds selfish at first. It did to me. But when I changed, like, in stuff like this, when I was writing down, instead of keeping a journal, and I realized that it was just a daily or semi-daily bitch session.
Mm-hmm.
At one point, I realized I just kept finding more things to bitch about. Once I caught on to that, I started writing things like, I'm proud of you, Kev.
Mm-hmm.
And I love you, Kev. And I would put like a smiley face with it. Now you can call that Pollyanna if you want. I was not used to hearing myself talk to myself that way.
Yeah.
And then I started to investigate what that meant about, like, no matter what's going on in the world around me, even with the relationship that I'm in, with what my kids are doing, with what's happening at work. I can't control any of that. I might be able to affect it, mm-hmm. but I don't have any control over it.
No.
I think that's why the Serenity Prayer is a fundamental part of AA.
Yes.
It's got it right for all of life, in my opinion and experience,
absolutely.
Is that once you can start to be good with yourself and to reaffirm and to program into your subconscious mind, Google Bob Proctor. And mm-hmm. and how to change your paradigm and how your conscious brain gets in the way, but your subconscious is the one that's running the show. Mm-hmm. Once you get your subconscious thinking and believing, everything's okay.
Yeah.
And
I'm
you
can
all right.
do that with affirmations, with, you know, every day. And I write, I have a gratitude jar. So every day I write down something I'm grateful for. It's not, you know, big. It could be just the slightest thing, like I found a new tea that I like, or, you know, anything. And I'll write it down and I'll put it in my gratitude jar. And it just kind of sets my mind for the day of living in a place of being more grateful. And just because I think it's so easy to, like you say, you know, have a daily bitch session about this, that, and the other. It's so easy to stay in a negative place. But if you just retrain your mind to just for a few minutes think about something positive, I have really found a difference in how my outlook on everything, you know, throughout the day, when I start my day with just a few minutes of gratitude.
Yeah, it's amazing. And I'm glad that you brought it up, Steph, because it is a process.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we look to other people. I look to other people that I aspire to be more like. But it's a process.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess if you can embrace that and realize that your best is going to vary from day to day. Another book I would strongly recommend is The Four Agreements by Don Miguel Ruiz. You know, don't make assumptions. Don't take anything personally. Be impeccable with your word and always do your best, and your best is going to range. But that don't make assumptions. I even just put out a couple of video blogs recently about how many times we guess during the course of a day about what we think is going on with somebody else, or what someone means, or why someone hasn't returned that text or whatever. And if you really think about it, how often we assume, how much muck and crap we're carrying around shaping our worldview of stuff that isn't even true.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we just think it is.
That's where I'm at right now. That's the part of the journey I'm on right now. The drink bit I've dealt with, I've put that to bed, and now I'm getting rid of all the other garbage that I've dragged along with me for so long. And I'm just, it's funny, me and Steph talk about this daily, but I'm only just starting to come to terms with, it doesn't matter if someone doesn't like me. It used to absolutely kill me, the thought of someone disliking me. But now it doesn't really matter. And as you said earlier, Kevin, it's not my problem. That's their problem. You know, and I've done the same. I've started to unfollow and block a few people, a few things, and really work on how I feel about things and learn that it actually doesn't matter. That's their problem, not mine.
Mm-hmm.
So as I say, it's very early days. Steph's a lot longer on this road than I am. But yeah, this is all good stuff that you're saying for me, because, you know, this is where I'm, the next 6 months, this is what I'll be concentrating on nonstop. You know?
And it doesn't matter where Steph is or where I am, right?
Mm.
Or for me, where somebody else is. You are where you are.
Yeah.
Just take the next step. Just take the next one. You know, one, here we go again. One step at a time, one round at a time, one punch at a time, right?
Yeah.
One at a time, one day at a time, one moment. And because they add up fast.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
Definitely.
Wow, this has been really, really wonderful. Thank you so much, Kevin. What a treat.
I'm glad that you've enjoyed it. I have too. And, Steph, it's just an absolute pleasure to make your acquaintance, and I look forward to getting to know you better and collaborating creatively going forward. And Glenn,
I wanted this day to happen for so long. You know, even back in the day when I was at my worst, you know, I always dreamed. And the reason that I didn't, when you were speaking earlier, I followed you all the way along, and you probably don't realize that because we lost contact for a bit when I was going further down the rabbit hole and you were just going up and up, but I followed you all the way. And I've spoke to Steph about you a lot, you know, and it's only recently I've started messaging again, probably in the last probably 3 months, I think 4 months ago, I sent you a message out of the blue just going, hey, how are you? And that was because I was finally comfortable with where I was at. And I was like, and I'm not trying to aspire to you. I'm not. That's not what I'm saying. But I was finally comfortable enough with myself to say, right, I can go to Kevin now and I can start this conversation again. Because I knew you wouldn't judge, not a problem. But it was a problem I had, you know. And that's what this was. And I've been looking forward to this for so long. And yeah, it's been absolutely fantastic. And it only gets better. We're all on the up now, and it's just all good stuff from now on, isn't it? You know.
Yeah, I consider you a brother. I really do.
Thank you. Thank you.
And I will get there. I will get over there. Like it's just TikTok. I might have to turtle my way across. But I will get there, and we will go on a hike together or whatever it is that we want to do. It'd be a lot easier for me and Steph because geography is not all that much of an issue. I could be there this afternoon, as it turns out.
That's right.
But this is, you know, it's about living, right? It's not about winning. It's about living. But the interesting thing is that once you start to tune in and you realize, whoa, wait a second, I'm really living here, then it feels like you're winning. And I think all the three of us are winning, and I applaud the two of you so much for putting yourselves out there and offering this, because somebody's going to see it.
Yeah.
Somebody's going to, and it doesn't matter how many views, there's going to be at least one person, right?
Yeah.
That's going to see it, and it will make a difference.
Mm-hmm.
And then they will go on to make a difference for themselves and everybody else, and that's how it happens, but we can't be afraid to show each other who we really are. And so I applaud you, and I couldn't be more grateful for the invitation to come on here. And now you can be forewarned, if you ever want to do this again, block out some time if you want to talk to Kevin. Sorry.
That's fantastic.
No, it's been wonderful. Thank you so much.
Yeah, definitely. Do you want to wrap this up, Steph?
Yes. Well, again, just thank you so much for joining us. And it's our hope. The reason we're doing this, you know, it's our motivation entirely is helping other people, because for me, helping others, just knowing, even if it's just one person, like it's such a massive part of, you know, keeping me sober and keeping me going, knowing that I'm helping someone else out there. So thank you from the bottom of my heart. Thank you.
Yeah, that's all I want to say as well, Kevin. Just a massive thank you. It's been a real pleasure, this. What is it, an hour and 20 or something? It's just flown by. It's been fantastic. Thank you very much.
Yeah.